Now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full, I traveled each and every highway and more, much more than this. I did it my way. Regrets, I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do, and saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew. But through it all, when there was doubt, I ate it up and spit it out. I faced it all, and I stood tall, and did it my way. I've loved, I've laughed and cried, I've had my fill, my share of losing, and now, as tears subside, I find it all so amusing to think I did all that, and may I say, not in a shy way. Oh no, oh no, not me. I did it my way. For what is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not to say.
Hi. Thanks for coming. You listen, kid. We're so grateful to be here to celebrate and honor the life of Bert Randall Ogborn. I'm his son, Brandon, nicknamed Bubba to some of you. I see about half of you are incredibly sad that my dad passed because you won't be able to borrow money from him anymore. And the other half of you are thrilled that he's dead because you won't have to pay him back. Raise your hand if you're on my dad's family plan with AT&T. That's going to be ending at the end of the month, so I recommend T-Mobile. The outpouring of love that we've received in hilarious stories and tributes on my dad have really got us through this week. We've received so many meals and gift cards, and truly we can't express how helpful it's been with this initial shock and figuring out his end of life and afterlife with a house full of siblings and spouses to not have to worry where the next meal is, or are we out of toilet paper again, Brandon, why are you still in the bathroom? I think I have problems. But it's enabled this incredibly peaceful and joyful household where we've all been toiling away on different projects, putting poster boards together, dealing with the estate, insurance, figuring out the ceremony, and helping my mom without want for anything. We love you, and it's not lost on us that the generosity of my dad in life is coming back to us now. My mom opened the refrigerator the other day, and the food was spilling out, and she said, "This is God, this is your dad." And she said it reminded her of Luke chapter 6, verse 38, "A good measure pressed down, shaken together, and runneth over will be poured onto your lap. For the measure you use it, it will be measured to you." And our cups run over with God's grace and the many blessings you all have given us up to this day, and I'm sure after. We love the ham sandwiches. My wonderful cousin, Pastor Justin Isaac, said, "No, he's not one of the property brothers. He'll be leading us in a prayer." And the Reverend Al Farkas, my dad's best friend and a close second for the richest man in town and friends, will be reading the eulogy. I'll then give a speech, and then we'll open up to some of you who may have some thoughts or stories about Bert to share. Only the good stuff, though. No scrubs, no haters. I'm looking at you, Aunt Trudy. And there'll be a luncheon after the luncheon. I do have to make sort of a high school announcement. We did not anticipate this many people, so the luncheon may have to be for immediate and extended family. There is a Chick-fil-A, and I stand by them. Cousin Justin.
Dear friends and family, thank you for coming here to show your love and support to my uncle. And his family, and being here to support them. Knowing my uncle my whole life, this is perfectly representative of his life that he gave to people. So thank you for coming here and supporting him. So let's take a moment and let's pray together. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all of our affliction. We thank you that you are not a God who is distant and uncaring, but you are a Father who feels deeply for his children. You are close now, gently bearing our grief. I am grateful that you are no stranger to pain and darkness. Jesus, you are a man of sorrows and acquainted with our grief. Surely you have borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Together we mourn this unfathomable loss, and we feel and hurt deeply. There are no words that can justify this loss. For Bert's family, we pray for Cathy. We love you, Cathy. Father, we ask that you would comfort her most of all. Would you gently guide her for each day that follows, through the dark times, but also the joyful times ahead, with her family? Would your presence and the presence of others give her meaningful comfort and strength in this time? For Bert's children, Rebecca, Brandon, Alexis, and their families, we love you. Would you, your present comfort, strengthen them and guide them as well? May they be strengthened together as a family in this time. And God, we thank you that you are near to the brokenhearted and you save the crushed in spirit. We lean on you and each other this morning. Give us our comfort and our peace. In your grace and your strength, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Wow, what a great representation of a man that was about his community, about family, and about love. I'm so glad that you have all come here today to celebrate the life of Bert. My heart is full, and we are all broken, but we're going to get through this, and we're gonna get through it together. Amen. To Cathy, to the kids, to the family, and all the friends who have gathered here today in this moment of remembrance, let us find comfort in loving and embracing one another. And together we cherish the beautiful memories and the indelible mark left by a soul who touched all the lives that he knew in countless ways. Let us begin the morning with a spirit of unity for the time that we were privileged to share with Bert Randall Ogborn. I like to call him all three names because every time I call him, he'd say, Albert Tyler Farkas. Real slow. So, right back at you. Bert woke up every day of his life with an agenda. It was part of his DNA. That's just who he was. He lived by the same creed as one of his mentors, Abraham Lincoln. In the end, it's not the years of your life that count. It's the life in your years. Bert had a unique ability to live life at full throttle. One of the things that Bert and I spoke of often in this last year of our journey together was how the vast majority of society was changing so fast and was so busy, which is not a bad thing in itself, but it's being busy without purpose that caught our attention. I'm glad that we had that perspective together, that we could reflect together about life and how fast it was moving and the important things for us. Most people did not know Bert really as a spiritual person. We would often have prayer before we indulged in the many projects that Bert had going on in life, and trust me, he had many. But Bert had a very personal relationship with God that became evident in his compassion to others. Bert was inundated with many trials that tested his character in the last couple of years. The loss of his parents, the buyout of Edward's janitorial service, the merging of Al's cleaning service and the new accounts that were added, and the challenge of hiring others during the pandemic, and also the near death of his best friend, Al. He was also finishing an app game called The Game of Politics. We prayed a lot for the whirlwind of responsibility that we were involved in, always praying earnestly for our families that we were so closely entwined over the years. We had just enough smarts to know that we stood little chance of solving life's complicated problems on our own. That's why we always prayed Deuteronomy 32:29. Oh, that they were wise, that they would understand this, that they would consider their latter end. We knew no matter how challenging life was to always keep in mind that making it to heaven and taking our families with us was our greatest priority. Through all of the projects, through everything that we did, his love shined through for family and shined through for our friendship and for all those that we were involved with. We knew that our godly character and our love for others had to shine first. We knew that we always had to keep in mind that going to heaven and taking our families with us, that was our journey. Through our life journey, Bert always had an incredible calm about things. He would drive me absolutely nuts. Slow to speak. Slow to anger. Do you have any emotion? He was steadfast in love and devotion to family and lived an incredible love story with the love of his life, Cathy. Cathy and Bert, excuse me, were a true example to my wife and I of how to raise kids and how to love their kids wholly and completely and how to love each other and be faithful. And you'll learn why that was so important for me to lift him up as a mentor in my life in a few minutes as I tell our story, Bert and I's story. Even though Bert was not emotional, he showed others his emotion and love through his actions. He was able to display calm and always be there for others in spite of his own challenges, mostly because he had his life ending figured out. We were blessed in our friendship to know what took priority over everything else in our life, and that was putting God first, family second. Amen. Bert loved this story. I mean, he always came to, you know, I've preached a lot of different funerals, and he even came to my church when my wife and I were pastoring and so forth. And so he heard this story, and he always, you know, another mentor of his was Winston Churchill. Of course, those of you that knew Bert, he loved these kind of stories. But in passing, Bert would want me to mention to you that no matter what the challenge you have in life, to consider the importance of your latter end. Death is not final. This life here is not forever. We are just passing through this life. Bert lived his life fully, but he had the same understanding as Winston Churchill. Winston Churchill planned his funeral before he died. His wishes called for a bugler, a guy that played the bugle, positioned high in the dome of the beautiful St. Paul's Cathedral to play taps after the benediction. Taps were meant to represent the physical life was over, its last call, it's the end of the day. But then came the most dramatic turn as the taps were finished. Another bugler, placed on the other side of the great dome, played the notes of reveille. It's time to get up. It's time to get up. It's time to get up in the morning. At the end of history, the last note will not be taps. It will be reveille. Winston Churchill had the unique understanding that death was not the end, but rather the beginning. You will wake up on the other side. The truth is that all that will matter in the end is what you lived for when it's last call. Bert Randall Ogborn left us unexpectedly, for sure. But in his short time here with us, he lived an incredible life that touched so many. It is because of his influence in my life that I am here today giving this eulogy. So I would be amiss if I did not tell you the story of how Bert and I came to be best friends and how our families became so intertwined over the last 45 years. Due to the meeting of this one man, Bert Ogborn, my life would never be the same. While I was growing up, I had a challenged and dysfunctional childhood, the opposite of what Bert had in family. According to my school, I think I was destined to be an astronaut because they told me I just took up space. As a young boy, we moved often because of family problems. As a result, I was never able to be a part of the same school for 1 year at a time. I grew up with severe learning disabilities and social disorders, and I was labeled a special ed kid. I remember crawling under my bed at night, and I would dream of being a part of a normal family, trying to escape the reality of the environment I was living in. As a result of the craziness, I became hardened in my heart. Deeply rooted in my personality was hidden anger, and I was unmanageable and became a problem child, and I soon became a problem adult. My introduction to Bert came when my first child was born. Unfortunately, she was born with premature lungs, and they had to rush her by helicopter to a neighboring prenatal hospital, where she was with a nurse by her side for 24 hours for 4 months. I quit my job and I stayed at the hospital, and I was sleeping in the waiting areas and dying in my car, and they told me that it was unlikely that she would make it. And if she did, she would be severely challenged due to all the oxygen that she had to have. And of course, I was frantic. I knew nothing about faith, praying, church, or even God for that matter. The only time I ever mentioned his name was, unfortunately, in vain. I was still living wild and carefree. But one thing I did have, despite myself, was a determination to have a normal family, one with children that I could love like they were supposed to be loved, children that would feel safe and loved in their own home. Because I knew nothing about God, I was desperate to find someone who did, who might be able to help me. Never having gone to a church or knowing anyone who was a professing Christian, I had limited resources to choose from. But I remembered hearing something about God on the radio. So I went down to my car to listen for this radio station. Now, for all you young little kids, they didn't have internet and Google and cell phones back then. So we had to do things the real way. So I found that radio station on that radio, and then I called it. Turns out it was a Christian radio station located right here in Muskegon, Michigan. After getting the number, I called and told the person on the line that my daughter was dying, and I was wondering if someone could come and pray for her, or that they would pray for her over the air. And he said, of course, we will request prayer from our listeners. And he said, I will be praying there for you also and come to visit. As a matter of fact, he said, I want to pray with you right now. I felt a little uncomfortable because, being who I was and the nature of the kind of person I was, I asked him to pray for my daughter, not me. But I allowed him to pray anyway. Then he requested something that would change my life forever. He told me that I should pray for my daughter also. And I told him why in the blankety blank 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 did you think I was calling you for? I said, I'm a heathen man. I don't know anything about God. I don't know how to pray. That's why I need someone like you. I need somebody on the inside, man. I need a Christian to pray. And he explained to me that God would indeed hear me if I would pray. I hung up on him, and I couldn't get that out of my mind. I thought, how am I going to pray? I never prayed before in my life. But I didn't want to do everything I could for my daughter to live. So I put my hands in the incubator and the gloves and touched my daughter. And I did something, the only thing that I knew how to do. I made a deal with God. God, if you'll let her live, I'll do everything I can to raise her for you. And I'll do everything I can for me to live for you also. To no one's surprise but my own, God kept up his end of the bargain. And my daughter was soon released from the hospital, completely healed, and she's here today. This would become the beginning of an intentional lifestyle for me. But now, fearful that the deal I made, I did not dare to turn back on my promise to God, not knowing what to do, I contacted the man from the radio station again. He ended up being a 16-year-old boy. By the time I met him, he was 17. His name was Bert Randall Ogborn.
This young man represented an innocent and godlike character that I respected. Excuse me for just a minute, please. He was an innocent guy. He was not like anybody I ever met. He began to disciple me, and he taught me Bible studies, and he also took me to a church for the first time. And it's a good thing that God knew what he was doing, because when I made that deal with him, because after my first experience with the church, I surely would have never gone back if it wasn't for the deal. Whew. Man, when I walked in that church, there were people standing up and raising their hands and dancing around. Some of them were crying, and others were clapping their hands. I thought, man, am I at a barn dance or, you know, man. And there was even some of them jumping up and down, and I thought, these people are a couple of fries short of a Happy Meal. But my mind kept flashing back to the deal that I made. And so I was scared, you know. I didn't know God. I just knew that I thought maybe if I reneged on the deal that he'd take my daughter. Just somebody that didn't know nothing. So I stuck it out. And even though I found much of it strange, for the most part, they were very sincere and seemed kind to me. Over the years, I came to love them all so dearly. And there's many of them here today. Without doubt, meeting my friend Bert and making a deal with God has molded me into the person I am today. My continuing love story is based, excuse me, with God has molded me into the person that I am today. My continuing life story is based on the one single event, that one single event in my life. My whole life is based on that one event. Bert's family took me in. We spent so many hours, Cathy, sitting at that kitchen table, talking about business ideas and selling vitamins and selling recipes. We even sold recipes through the mail. You can see the first checks that we received. We sold pizza potatoes, and you could buy the recipe for $10. Of course, the attorney general wrote us and said that we were involved in a mail fraud, and it's time to cease. So. But wow, did we have some times. Bert's family took me in to share many, many, many wonderful times out on the farm, watching old reel-to-reel movies, eating ice cream sundaes, cookouts, football games with the Isaacsons. You wonder how we got so fat. Amen. Summer picnics, and we even vacationed together as families, and individually, just Bert and I. If you knew my friend Bert, you could always find him making his rounds at the Goodwill stores, finding all the good yard sales, and most of the time he did not need the things he would buy, but Bert just loved a good deal, and Cathy would get so mad at him. He would buy all different kinds of things with the intention of reselling them and making a fortune. I remember one time when he came home with boxes, I think over 1,000 pairs of shoes. What are you going to do with all them shoes, Bert? I'm going to make a fortune. He's always buying guns, and he even got me wrapped up into buying some. Then my wife, Debbie, she would ask me, what do you need all these guns for? So I would sell them back to Bert. And he would have them for a while, and I'd decide I wanted them back, so he'd sell them back to me. Then we'd go to the gun show together and we'd both buy more. We also went on vacations together, just Bert and I many times, and we adopted our Tom, Uncle Tom, and he came with us on one as well. We called them mancations. No women allowed. Tom's wife even made us t-shirts that said mancationers. Yeah. Shooting gangster guns at the gun place, machine guns, riding on airboats in the Everglades, seeing alligators, racing on go-karts around the racetrack, going to the animal kingdom, bush gardens, zoos, helicopter rides, swimming with dolphins, sea turtles, stingrays. We went to SeaWorld and sat in the splash zones together like a couple of kids, all the time talking about our dreams and encouraging one another. We had the greatest of greatest adventures together. I'm the luckiest of men. But the greatest thing he ever did, of course, was win me to the Lord. Bert gave me my first Bible in 1984. Inscribed in the beginning, on the first page, is presented to Albert Tyler Farkas from Bert Ogborn. Proverbs 3, 4, 5, and 6. Now to my kids and to all of you, you know why I have that scripture posted all over my office, all over my house, all over my stories. It's because that became me. It reads, "To find favor with God and man, trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all thy ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths." Thank you, Bert, for that wisdom inscribed in this Bible all those years ago. Today, we are certainly leaning on God and not our own understanding for this loss. For our understanding in your early departure from this earth, we need to lean on God. In closing, one of the things that Bert and I did later, as we become accustomed to our friendship, was on every Friday, and this was before the pandemic, for years, my kids called it bromance. But we went out for dinner every Friday, and we went to movies every Friday. And he would always call me from work, because he worked right down the road at Structural Concepts. And he's gone now, so he can't get in trouble for, if you're here for Structural Concepts, too bad. So sad. But he would leave work and he would go down to the movie theater and he would buy the tickets for whatever movie we chose and save a seat for me. Then I would meet him and I would buy the refreshments and we'd share in fellowship. And in closing, I know an assurance. Save a seat for me, my friend. Thank you for allowing me to share about this great man and what he meant to this community and to all of us.
I just love Al. I'm sure Bert's looking down right now and saying, is this the 2023 Conservative Political Action Committee? My dad's death was ruled accidental by the Muskegon County Coroner, but we all know who was behind it.
The Clintons. Crooked Hillary. The corrupt Biden crime family. It's all part of the Russia.
As you know, um,
I can keep going.
As you know, and read in the obituary, my dad was a lot of things. He was an entrepreneur, a great father, an incredible sibling to his four sisters, a dedicated son to his parents and helping shepherd in them in their aging years. And he was a follower of Jesus in the truest sense. He didn't judge others. He only offered guidance and help. And he gave so much to so many. His generosity oftentimes drove my mom nuts, especially when we were young children and we were brutally, brutally poor. And he would just give things away, give cars away, give groceries for people when we had next to nothing. But his mission was to bring the peace and unconditional love of Jesus into this world. And he did that with his many selfless deeds. And we also know he was a talker, which is something I inherited from him and why I'm looking at my wife, Jenna, to just give me the signal. I read one of the comments. I don't know if the person is here. It's kind of a blur, but somebody on Facebook wrote that they ran into him at Meijer. And I guess they were there with their son, and my dad was just talking and talking, talking and talking. And when he left, the guy's son said, "Man, does that guy have anywhere to be?" I remember once at Meijer, this is true, he talked so long that my mom left him. And we were home, we were little kids, and the phone rang like 2 hours later. And my dad was at Meijer, and he's like, "Hey, is your mom there? I need a ride." We know Bert did have a lot to do from Al, of course. He was incredibly and incessantly busy, and so busy that sometimes there are long and frequent phone calls when I was an adult where we argued politics. He was obviously a Republican. If you don't know, I'm a flat earther. And our calls happened less and less after the 2020 election denying, because we all know it was rigged. And by trade, my father was a draftsman and a technical writer, which is to say his vocation was making lines and connecting dots. And when I look out at all of you here, I'm trying to piece together which weird church you're from and how I knew you. But it's also people from different schools, different walks of life that... you all probably met my dad by just, I don't know, he just came up to me and started talking. But he knew how to draw the lines for someone and connect the dots to bring them into a community, to get them a job or get their kid a job or get them a ride somewhere to church or to work, to find someone to pray with them. Total strangers, sometimes dangerous and derelict people like Al used to be. By the way, Al, I don't know how you outlive my dad. Al is like 50% cyborg. And Charlie Bridwell back there, I mean, he was bringing you Chick-fil-A in the cancer ward. Like, this is insane. My dad would drive an hour each way to Grand Rapids, and he would sneak Chick-fil-A under his jacket for Charlie, and he'd stay an hour at least every single time in between everything he had going on. He was one of the best friends people could ask for. Growing up, my dad documented everything. He took incessant videos of us as children. He digitized thousands of hours of audio and video. He photographed everything, which is something you'll probably notice I do. He has massive terabytes of hard drives that have scanned images of letters we wrote as kids, crafts, business ideas, correspondence. He's got audio cassettes he digitized of just him putting us to bed for a half hour. It's going to take us years to parse through all of it. It's like he almost knew how brief and precious life was, so he did everything he could to save it, to catalog it. I'll be honest, what's on those hard drives is mostly garbage. There's like 200 pictures of him cleaning out an industrial refrigerator in the driveway. But a lot of the cataloging is beautiful. We've, as I've said, gathered as a family this last week, and we're putting together the puzzle pieces of his life. And the house just rumbles with laughter between the pauses of grief that are starting to set in. All the stuff he left behind, all the notes and recordings and photographs, maybe it was his way to look back and have us see the world the way he did, that it was so brief and even the mundane. And as an adult, there's so much that's mundane, but to Bert, all of it was miraculous. Every bit of it to him was an honor to experience. He loved us children deeply. He loved my mom deeply. He loved his friends deeply. He loved doing deep scriptural research about the end times deeply. I don't understand how someone who consumes that kind of material can be so cheerful. I mean, you go out and it's like he's Jimmy Stewart in town and he's just like, oh, hello there, do you want to work for my cleaning company? I pay slightly above minimum wage. He was never afraid of anything, especially taking a chance. I remember getting lost down in Florida as a kid, and he pulled over in a Kmart, pitch black, reading his Atlas map, and somebody knocked on the window. Bert would always roll it down. How you doing? He'd give them money. He'd hear their spiel. It was probably all lies, but he'd always give them money, and he'd say, the guy's going to mail me a check back. And my mom would say, it's a scam, Bert. And he'd say, well, he needed it more than me. He started so many businesses, taking over a cleaning company, as Al talked about, and making it successful, Edwards Janitorial. Mr. Edwards is here today, and I had a wonderful time speaking with him. He spent a decade and a half on an insane conservative board game idea, which nearly bankrupted the family. And we found out, as some of you may know from the developer, that he amazingly finished it on the day that he died. And you can download the app. For $1.99, there's a QR code on the back of your program. That will go to the Setting Up Cathy Fund to therapy shop at TJ Maxx. He gambled the board game idea, and he gambled on so many things. He also gambled. I mean, he actually gambled. He wasn't degenerate level, but it was pretty close during his blackjack phase, which preceded the collecting rocks and seashells phase. On your seat, you may have seen a dice. Those were Bert's. They weren't expensive. He probably got them off Craigslist. We had a suitcase full of them. But I want you to take it with you, not just as a keepsake, but to remember Bert, that he always took chances. He always risked. And I encourage you to take chances and risk, be it later in life or in your early years, to be vulnerable, to risk your honesty, to risk your goodwill, to risk adventure, to risk deep love for your family and friends and community. I look back on my dad's life and our family's relationship with him, and there are no regrets, besides me being a total jerk when I was a teenager. But he told everyone he cared for that he loved them and prayed for them. And I hope that in a tragedy like this, I know in a tragedy like this, there are no loose ends, and I hope you all get to leave this world the same. Rolling the dice, a smile on your face, and a 5-star eBay review. Everybody, I appreciate it. We appreciate it so much. If anybody's wondering, there's a photo of my dad out there shirtless with some male models. I just want to clarify what happened. They were at the Mall of America, and there was a fashion show taking place with Abercrombie models, and my dad was so disgusted with their washboard abs that he pushed through the crowd and ripped his shirt off and jumped on stage and began to dance. The whole crowd went wild. Thank you so much. Head out the back.